Good morning to all. I'm happy to be here with you. I will give a very brief version of my case study, stressing on the main topics and categories, either particular, individual, or common with other case studies. I will mainly present you the material available for this case study, like maps, plans, drawings, visuals more. And I will emphasize on the specific meaning and the task assigned to modernism in this operation. And I will explain the role held by the landscape in the creation of a new national cultural identity and the legacies of heritage of this operation. Now about the general context, few words. After the Greco-Turkish War in Asia Minor in 1922 and the Treaty of Lausanne in 1923 ratified the compulsory exchange of populations between Greece and Turkey, creating a refugee problem on a scale hitherto unknown in regions already facing a demographic disaster. Greece received 1.2 million Greek refugees from Asia Minor, nearly one-fourth of the total Greek population at the time, as against 400,000 Muslims that departed to Turkey. The arrival of the refugees, however, led to a dramatic acceleration of land reform, to an extensive development program funded by international loans, and became a fundamental part of the nation building process. Northern Greece received the majority of the refugees, which increased the percentage of Greek population considerably. By 1923, Greece requested economic support and technical assistance to the League of Nations, which established the Refugee Settlement Commission, an autonomous supranational body, to administer foreign loans and develop a comprehensive housing program. The RSC was mainly responsible for the rural settlement. By 1928, the RSC has established over 2,000 rural settlements throughout Greece. Almost half of it were in Macedonia and Thrace, and another number in Crete. This is the colonization map of Greek Macedonia region. It is significant of the changes in the settlement network. Of the communities established by RSC in the area, 646 were entirely new villages for the refugees, and another 442 settlements were new quarters added to native Greek villages. One of the main responsibilities of the RSC was land distribution. The cadastral service established in 1927 under the direction of the commission had the task of surveying and distributing of land, taking care of parceling and allotment for housing and farming lot, issuing of title deeds, drawing of plans and diagrams until 1930, when the RSC has finished his job. To ameliorate the tight land situation, the government undertook major land reclamation works in the plains of Thessaloniki and Serres. You can see them with these black circles marked on the map. In these regions, the there was an abundance of stagnant waters and swamplands, flood of rivers, a situation that did not allow the full exploitation of the soils. Particularly on the Lake of Giannitsa, which was known as the theater of the struggles for the liberation of Macedonia in the early 20th century, there is an interesting material, visual, historical, and also of literature. Thus, extensive drainage and land development works had to be planned in the Macedonian plains after 1925 and implemented by mid-1930s. Meanwhile, before the implementation of these works, the RSC established in the immediate vicinity of the lake 44 new villages and quarters. This is a technical plan of the reclamation works in both these valleys, the valley of Axios River and Strymon Rivers. The contracts for the reclamation projects were given to three American firms. You can see them marked in this slide. From the technical viewpoint, reclamation meant drainage of swampland, adjusting the size and shape of river banks, building irrigation canals, and diverting the mouth and courses of rivers to prevent the accumulation of silt along the coast, which was threatening the development of commercial harbors. The drainage of the Macedonian plains radically transformed the landscape of the area. Over 80,000 hectares were turned into fertile land, and a large number of new refugee villages were located on reclaimed lands at a short distance from one another. I will not go into the consequences of the above policies to the agriculture, neither to the impact they had on the network of settlements in northern Greece. There is a huge literature on those topics. I will only stress that this policy gave rise to a large class of peasant smallholders at the juncture when ongoing forced collectivization of agriculture in the USSR was placed as the foundation of the future society. Now, on the local level, about the village pattern. We have collected the material of circa five village monographs with detailed demographic and economic data, plans and photos. The standard settlement pattern, whether native, mixed or entirely refugee, was that of a compact village surrounded by farms allocated for cultivation. Farm parcels allocated to each family were scattered in various places according to the quality of the soil and the estimated type of crop. Concerning the village form, new refugee settlements were totally characterized by a regular layout which had been alien to both villages and towns of northern Greece until the beginning of the 20th century. Former settlements of the area had always grown incrementally. Houses were built one after the other, forming narrow, winding streets. In areas where abundant and exchangeable housing was available, refugee settlements retained the original street layout, as in this village, where the refugee settlement occupied the former Bulgarian quarter to the east. Plans were drawn by the RSC for new village, refugee villages or quarters, and they adopted the gridiron pattern with regular blocks, convenient to allocate standard building lots for individual houses and to arrange a central public space for the communal amenities, mainly the central square with the village hall, the church and the school. In general, there was a strong connection between the regular street layout of the village and the allotment of its fields. Villages of this type are to be found mainly on the reclaimed lands of Axios and Serres Valley. They form the rural landscape which persists to present day. The outcome of this operation was the distinguished feature of the village, of the refugee villages, with plans following a simple functionalism which disregarded the cultural background of the Now at the micro level, the dwelling types. Between 1924 and 30, a total of over 50,000 new rural houses were built all over Greece, in addition to those built earlier by the state, and a big number of the exchangeable dwellings left by the departed mostly. Circa 10,000 new dwellings were commissioned to the German company Sommerfeld Dehatege, and were completed by May 1925. The company applied three types of dwellings, fully standardized, in dimensions depending on the size of the family. The company built masonry foundations, type timber frame and tile roof, while refugees were to fill the walls with material available on the spot. At this point, entered two prominent figures of the German technical milieu, the contractor Arnold Sommerfeld and his chief architect Fred Forbach, both affiliated to Bauhaus and with an extensive activity in Germany and abroad. I don't have the time to present their activity now, but I will be happy to answer any questions later. The company perceived, conceived this large-scale project of mass-produced settlers for the rural refugees in Greece as a recovery model in situations of humanitarian crisis. Its standardized patterns and management reflects the use of technology, rationality and order to the production of mass housing related to the modernization process in the first half of the 20th century. Here are some notes about Sommerfeld and Forbach. And here you can see the implementation of the spot of the Dehatege dwellings. And some landscapes, village landscapes that were developed by the application of this type of dwelling. Since these houses proved to be rather expensive, the RSC decided to entrust another over 21,000 rural dwellings to small local firms working under the control of the RSC. And the plans were devised, after the Dehatege typology. The use of standard plans for refugee housing, which only few examples survives today, showed a trend towards in architectural uniformity and regularity throughout Greece. Lastly, this is my last topic. I would like to stress very briefly on the issues of the settlement landscape as part of the new cultural national identity and the question of heritage. There is a lot of material to explore these issues, visuals, videos, documentaries, as well as interviews and memoirs by second and third generation descendants. To begin with, the labouring of the harsh soils and fields and the involvement of inhabitants to the making of the village may be understood as a domestication and appropriation process of the new environment. They had a key role in the development of the sense of belonging. The perception of the novel life setting by the inhabitants play also an essential role. The regular village form, as compared to the irregular shape of their lost villages and the ready-made houses, acted as an efficient cultural instrument. They fostered the modernization of previous ways of life and allowed their assimilation in the new homeland. The example of Neos Kopos offers an insight to this role. Late in the 1930s, the Zionist leader David Ben-Gurion visited the village, this village, and took the housing plans with him to Palestine for use in Israeli settlement plan. Presently, of the original village landscape survives the gridiron layout pattern, distinctive of the refugee village form. The gradual improvement of the economic situation of the villagers led in the last decades to the replacement of the modest initial dwellings by bigger and more comfortable houses. And maybe a most impressive element of the region remains the landscape of the reclaimed plains, now completely naturalized. Well, none of these, of those artifacts were protected for conservation. However, integrated now into the broader regional setting, they are perceived as the most recent stratum of the region's multi-layered heritage that reflects the historic course of the area, offering a solid support to the sense of belonging to the inhabitants. You can see here the Google map of the Giannitsa Lake and the relics of the different of the heritage taken from different eras, like the Macedonian tombs and the ancient capital, the relics of Roman Via Ignatia, the former lake landscape, the 15th century Ottoman town Yenice, the relics of a medieval cemetery, and late 19th century deep rural estates. Thank you very much.